our spring 2023 David L. Guy lecturer, Yeonmi Park. Born in North Korea, human rights activist and TED speaker, Yeonmi Park grew up in a punishing society devoted to the worship of Kim Jong-il. But at the age of 13, she and her family made a daring escape to China in search for a life free of tyranny. In her viral talks, viewed online nearly 350 million times, Park urges audiences to recognize and resist the oppression that exists in North Korea and around the world. Tonight, she's going to take us on a journey, her own journey. It's a tragic journey. It's a shocking journey, but it is her journey. As she shares her journey with us, take a moment to think about all of those who are still experiencing that journey. Please give a warm and loud maroon welcome to Yeonmi Park.
Thank you everyone for coming today. Actually, Roanoke is a very special place in my heart. This is the first place that I came when I came to America. I went to Tyler, Texas for Bible study, and a friend that I met, Esther, she was from Roanoke. So she brought me here to have first American Thanksgiving and Christmas. And I still remember she was taking me to the Roanoke Star, yeah, and the museum. And that was my first time actually saw the American home. When we entered the home, the door was just going up by itself. It was a parking garage door. Once I got into the car, like inside, I was like, is this your home? Like, yeah. And then there was a staircase going upstairs. Now I'm thinking it was a normal size American home, but as a North Korean, it was a palace that I was getting into. And I asked her, like, is your parents are very special people? They were like, no, they are selling wigs. This is how normal Americans live here. And that day, I was praying in my heart, deep in my heart. Maybe someday, if I'm very, very, very lucky, I might be able to come back to this country. Because back then, coming to America was not even in my imagination. That was such a, you know, almost reaching for the stars, that kind of dream. Here I am, as an American. I became American last year, and living. Thank you. And living as a free person. So that's why I keep saying that, you know, anything is possible in life. When I was born in North Korea, the very, very first thing that I learned from my school teachers were how horrible American bastards were. By the way, that was the same word. American bastards were the same word. Even in my math book, it was like, there are four American bastards. You kill two of them. How many American bastards left to kill? And we don't have internet in North Korea. We don't even know what that is. It's the only idea of America that I could understand from my teachers were these school posters where American monsters, they were cold-blooded reptiles. They were like pulling teeth out of our women, eating our children, torturing our people. And my school teachers were telling me, you are so lucky because you have our dear leader Kim Jong-il protecting us from these horrible Americans. That's why we were so lucky that we had nothing to envy in this world. And now I came to America, at the first time I was looking at Americans, first of all. Before even I was thinking about my propaganda, I was thinking, why everybody look the same here? Everybody look the same. So I don't blame when people think all Asians look the same. I felt exactly the same. And I came to America to study at the university. And, you know, like, I'm going to the promised land, the best country in human history, not just in the contemporary world. In entire human history, this has been the best country. this has been the possibility of what individuals can achieve when they are left from the government tyranny and when they have their own rights. So I come to America, and then I go to grocery store. The first thing that I went to in America was going to Walmart. My friend drove me to Walmart, and she's like, what do you need at your door? I mean, literally, there was just chips. The size of bag was like half size of me. And then I went to buy an apple, right? An apple. In the grocery store, my jaw dropped. There were a dozen different types of apples. Crisp apple, honey, gala, like I don't even know how to pronounce them. I go buy my toothpaste. I mean, there are mint scent, whining, blah, blah, like 30 different like paste. And I was thinking, this is the best country in human history. How a human being can have this many choices? Because when you live in a dictator's countries, you do not even have a choice. Remember when American media making fun of Kim Jong-un's haircut? And they were so saying, oh, poor North Koreans. All North Korean men have to have Kim Jong-un's poor haircut. We don't even have a choice what haircut we get for ourselves. Now in America, I get 30 different types of, you know, toothpaste. And luckily, when I came here, I was admitted to Columbia University in New York City. I was thinking, I'm going to get the best education, right? This is the best education. It's Ivy League University. I remember the first day at my university's orientation. My professors were asked us, stay angry. Stay outraged, because America is inherently evil system, and all the evil that is happening in the world is because of greedy capitalism and because of white men. And I was like, did I somehow go back to North Korea? Literally, this is the exact same thing that I was learning in North Korean classroom. My school teachers taught me that all the problems that we had in the world and the only solution for all the problems was a communist revolution. And it was my professors at Columbia University repeating exact same thing to me. So let's talk about how that utopia, socialist paradise, looked like. And I often tell people, I was born in the darkest place in the world. And if you actually see the satellite picture of North Korea at nighttime, it is really the darkest place because they don't have electricity. I have so many climate change activist friends in New York City. I tell them, please go to North Korea because we have Earth Day every day. We don't have any pollution. We don't have any energy consumption. It is literally utopia that you can imagine. Zero impact on nature, right? Born in that country, the very first thing that my mom taught me as a young girl was, don't even whisper. She said, because the birds and mice could hear me. She said, the most dangerous thing that I had in my body was my tongue. If I said one thing wrong, one word wrong, it was just not gonna only get me killed, it was going to kill 3 to 8 generations of my own family with me. That's how I learned not to even whisper and not to even think. And the threshold to get executed in socialist paradise is laughably low. People get executed because in North Korea, every classroom, every room have the portraits of dictators, Kim Il-sung, Kim Jong-il, Kim Jong-un, and their wife. In the middle of night, the officers would kick your door and come and with a cloth and wipe the portrait. If there's a tiny bit dust gathered on that portrait, that's how you end up getting executed because your royalty was not good enough. And when you end up in a concentration camp, the first thing that you cannot do is why you are there. If you are asking them, why did I end up in a concentration camp, they execute you on the spot. And now, with Kim Jong-un, he decided that even bullets are too precious for the people of North Korea. He's using this method hotboxing. In a metal box, put a human being in there and let them drain to death. That's how it kills people now in the 21st century. When I was growing up there, my only daily task was finding food. As you can see, I'm pretty petty on my high heels. North Koreans are on average 5 inches shorter than South Koreans because of malnutrition. And I'm a mother. I have 5-year-old boy right now. He's like 99th percentile in every way. And doctors keep confused, like, you're so small. His father is so small. How is he so big? Like, yeah, it's their secret to my lineage, right? In North Korea, when babies born, when often mothers do not make the breast milk because they're malnourished. There's no baby formula, so that's how babies die. And at school, instead of me learning about the world, in the mornings, I get brainwashed to believe that how amazing our dictators are and how horrible Americans are. In the afternoons, everybody, not even just elders or adults, even children at 5, we need to work in the collective form. And one task that I still remember from North Korea is collecting human feces. The government could not afford fertilizer, so they were demanding people to bring poop to the school so they could give it to the collective farm. And that was my job. Every afternoon, I was looking for human feces to bring to school. And this is, by the way, free education, socialist system of free healthcare, free education. And by the time when I was 13 years old, I could not no longer find any more grasshoppers or dragonflies to survive. And it's actually so ironic that I come to America. I was dreaming of eating steak and, you know, eating noodles, pasta. Now there's so many world leaders talking about the importance of eating insects to save the planet. I'm like, BS to that. They taste horrible. They're disgusting. I mean, humanity can, you know, get better. We can innovate. Like, we don't have to go back to eating insects time. And in New York City, all my friends are going to eating this insect energy bar now. I'm like, I'm done with that. I'm eating all the meat in the world I can. So surviving like that, and one day it dawned to us that we could not survive that way anymore, that we had to escape from North Korea. My sister, who was 16 years old, she crossed the border with her friend first. I wanted to go with her, but I couldn't go because I had a very horrible stomach pain. My mother took me to a hospital, and I remember this guy doctor just rubbed my belly and he said, "You might just have appendicitis." So that afternoon, he just cut me open without any painkiller. When he opened inside, what I had was just infection and malnutrition. But he was embarrassed because he misdiagnosed me, so he still removed my perfectly fine appendix. So when I go back to North Korea, I'm gonna sue him. This is a one American value that I learned, like, you need to sue people, right? after this surgery, this is really the last thing I remember seeing from my homeland was from our bathroom, from our hospital door to the outside the bathroom. Of course, we don't have indoor bathroom. There are piles of dead bodies of humans laying down there. But seeing a, you know, dead human body is like, for a North Korean, it's like looking at a tree. It's so normal. Like, every day I saw dead bodies. But this thing was stuck with me because there was a lady on top of all these piles of dead bodies, you know, wearing like flower patterned pants, and her mouth was just wide open, and her eyes were gone. The reason why her eyes were gone is because rats, when we die, they eat our eyes first, because that's the softest human tissue. And while this lady's everything gone in her soul, you'd see children chasing these rats because they are hungry. And when these children eat those rats, they get the disease and they die, and they read the rats eating these children back So we eat them, they eat us back. This cycle continues in North Korea. And that's when I thought, I have to escape no matter what. Right after a few days after that surgery, I found a note that my sister left me. And with my mother, we crossed that frozen Yalu River into China from North Korea. As soon as I crossed that river to China, the first thing that I was seeing was my mother being raped. And at 13, I did not know what that was because in North Korea, we don't have sex education. And after that, we heard that these people were telling us, they were not even threatening us. If you don't want to be sold as sex slaves in China, you have right to go back to North Korea. And my mother, I remember, somehow my mother was asking a 13-year-old child, what do you want to do, Yeonmi? Like, do you want to go back to North Korea? And one thing that made me want to stay in China, it was seeing a trash can for the first time in my life. In this home, there's some lady was helping us to finding some food along with these human traffickers. She was throwing things in this little box, like little bin or something. And I asked her, like, what's that? And she's like, it's a trash can, the things that you don't need, you throw. And as a North Korean, I was like, what do you mean you have things to throw in this country? I mean, as I said, in North Korea, like, we cannot even throw the poops away. Literally, there's nothing you can throw away in North Korea. That's how impoverished we are. And in China, they can afford to have a trash can. And I told my mom, I want to stay in China. Even if I went back to North Korea, if that was the case, I wouldn't be here today because I'd be long dead ago from malnutrition or just torture and execution from the government. They sold my mother for $65 in the 21st century as a sex slave. And they sold me just over $200 because I was child virgin and that was very precious. And these perverted Chinese human traffickers. And sometimes it's still hard to reconcile that fact because today I flew from New York. My flight cost more than how much I was worth. And I'm living in the same world. And these are two different realities. And because China had a one-child policy under the Communist Party, they are lacking more than 30 million women. More than 33 million men in China cannot find wives. So they sell North Korean women as their sex toys. There are four places that North Korean girls end up in China when they escape. Number one place is organ harvesting. They buy our bodies and just open our body and take the organs that they need and discard us like pigs. Second place they demand North Korean women is a brothels. There's even no window in those rooms. They put the girl and then let them get raped for like 500 times a day. And they don't last more than a few months and die. The third place is fake husband. A village of men or brothers or cousins buy a one girl and they go around and rape the girl. And I was luckily bought by another human trafficker. And he wanted to keep me as his mistress and did not want to sell me to a farmer. This man who bought me at 13 said, if I become his mistress, he was going to save my family for me. And I thought about killing myself, but I thought, if I sacrifice myself, I could save my mother and my father and my sister. So I did become his sex slave at 13. He did bring my mom back. He bought her back from the farmer that he sold and brought my sick father from North Korea to China, but eventually passed away. 2 years of slavery, when I was 15 years old, I met another North Korean defector woman, and she said something very shocking to me at the time. She said, Yeonmi, there are missionaries from South Korea that who are rescuing North Korean defectors. And they say that if we go to South Korea, we are going to be free. And in North Korea, guys, we don't even have a word for love. We don't have a word for freedom. We don't have a word for human rights. Do you know why? Because if you don't have the word, that means you don't understand the concept. That's why this language war that is happening in America is very concerning to me. That's how systemically North Korean regime removed those words. Kim Jong-un recently banned Mother's Day because he was afraid that if people love their mothers, we're not going to love him as much. So I asked this lady, like, what do you mean if I go to South Korea, I'm gonna be free? And she said, if you go to South Korea, you can wear jeans and you can watch K-dramas. Because I was a teenage girl, I wanted to wear jeans. In North Korea, if you wear jeans, you go to prison because jeans are made in America, therefore it's a symbol of capitalism. And people literally get executed for watching foreign films in North Korea. And that's when I thought, if there is a world like that exists where I can watch whatever movie I want to watch, where I can choose whatever the clothes I want to choose, I want to go there. And the path to freedom was literally walking across the frozen Gobi Desert into Mongolia. At 15, this missionaries gave me a one compass in our hand. If you pray very hard, God will hear you and he will show the miracle and lead you to freedom. And they said, the chance of making is 1%, but still there are people make it. So we chose that path, and that's why right now, how many people do you think made to America from North Korea? Just 209 of us over the last 80 years. Miraculously, I survived the Gobi Desert. I didn't get killed. I made it to South Korea when I was almost 16 years old. Now, back to America. Now, as I said, I became an American citizen last year. And that, I remember my interview session with my interviewer for the citizenship test. She was asking me one question. Like, have you ever persecuted anybody for their political opinions? If I said yes to her, I could not become an American citizen. And then I was thinking, so most of this cancel culture, anything that is happening right in the mainstream media, none of these people are qualified to become American. Because how many people in America currently getting canceled for their political opinions? Last year, I was invited to speak at FBI. Right 2 days before my event, FBI's head of diversity person calls me, and this lady says, because of your political opinions, we need to cancel your event. It's scary how many people forgot what it means to be an American. And the best thing I thought I have done was giving my son the American citizenship. In what country that a North Korean can have a child with an American bastard and have a half North Korean, half American baby? He's a true testament to freedom, what's possible. And when as I said, it scares me every day living in big cities like New York and Chicago. The professors, literally, the universities became an indoctrination camp. They don't teach you how to think, they tell you literally what to think. And exact same thing that North Korean teachers taught us to do. And they are all doing this in the name of equity, in the name of fairness. And to me is, I asked my classmates in New York City, like one day I was so puzzled. Like, so what about America that you hate so much that you want to dismantle this system and tear down the Constitution? And she said, you know, look outside. There are homeless people and there are billionaires. We have inequality in capitalism. That's why this system is so evil. And I was thinking, what do you mean you have inequality in this country? Because would you rather be equal and all dying from starvation? I mean, the inequality is a sign of progress. If you work hard, you are going to get rewarded. You are going to get promoted. Right? You can become literally a trillionaire if you want to. And inequality is something that we should cherish and celebrate as a society, not something we should fight against. What we should fight against is a starvation. That is poverty. That's the enemy. So that's why I'm here to now. I see so many American people are buying this beautiful language about fairness and equality of outcomes again in this country. And they keep telling me, the only problem with socialism is because it was never implemented correctly. How on earth we failed 21 times already? How many times do you need to try this ideology? Because in my life, nothing has been more dangerous than big government. Because even nothing, they imagine China, Soviet Union, North Korea, all these countries. They have committed the biggest mass murder in human history. And this is what we need to wake up and fighting back on this sugar-coated language of equity and fairness and diversity and inclusion. This idea is the real, actual evil. Whenever society embraced these ideologies, it brought death millions, and it still brings death to millions of people. Being free, we are in a minority. I keep saying I'm a human rights activist, and people keep coming to me and say, why do I have to care about human rights? And they never asked the animals activists, say, why do I have to care about dolphins and puppies? Like, because these animals cannot speak for themselves. There are more than 4 billion human beings cannot speak for themselves right now. They don't even know what it means to have a voice. So if you do not fight for human rights, do you think the machine is going to fight for us? Do you think the puppy is going to fight for us? This is the only thing that we can do as a human beings. So thank you again for y'all for having me and listening to my lecture today. Thank you so much, everyone. Q&A.
Thank you so much, Ms. Park. At this time, if anyone would like to ask some questions, you can line up behind the lady raising her hand. Oh. Alrighty, if you want to line up behind, sorry. Or right.
How long were you in the desert for when you were like traveling to Mongolia?
Thank you. Thank you for, by the way, being so brave. You know, it's like to me, like in America, even if you say the wrong things, you don't get executed. But people are still very afraid to speak up. I was just here one day because we chose like the coldest month of the year in February. So the guards would think like nobody's crazy enough to cross right now, right? And so we were not caught by the guards, thankfully. Yeah, thank you.
Hello. I was just wondering if you think that it's possible to find a balance between pure capitalism, which causes suffering, and pure socialism, which also causes suffering?
I mean, the suffering that capitalism causes seems very clear to me because it literally offers no real hardship to the people. And this is the one thing that I actually learned in America, people who live in the capitalist societies, that because not having a problem is actual problem. They need to make a problem. For instance, at Columbia, my friends were saying their problems in capitalist society. I asked them, like, what's your problem? Why you think you are so oppressed? They say, because I identify myself as a gender fluid. And so, by the way, I was in South Korea in 2014. I one day Googled, like, how to learn English. And my Google search said, watch American TV show, and was watching Friends. I watched Friends for 30 times and learned English. Now I'm starting Columbia in 2016, 2 years later. And then they started telling me there are 10,000 different pronouns there. And Friends, they did not tell me they as a pronoun. So I could not use that in my language to my classmates, and they were telling me that I'm so bigoted, that I'm oppressing them. So it feels like I really genuinely cannot see that what would be the actual problem that is caused by capitalism other than people's their own misjudgment. So would you give me an example? What could be the problem that capitalism give to people?
I don't really believe that the United States embodies pure capitalism. We have certain socialist policies that have worked out as well as some that haven't. So I just think that on either extreme, you run into problems of dogma and ideology where maybe the solution is not to pick a side, but to find a balance between sides.
Yeah, of course, like, America has a huge social welfare programs, and I don't think they are working, especially living in Chicago and New York now. I realize that more and more. I think I guess when it comes to that, it's not the capitalism for to me, it's more about the inefficiency of government and bureaucracy. And they are, how they're so bad at using public funds. And I'm a firm believer that big government is always a threat to people's freedom. So yeah, I would prefer living in a country that government is very much limited, is as little as possible, and individuals have their role in their life, in their community, and their children, like pretty much that. So I don't know if that answers your question, sorry. Yeah.
Hello, I was wondering, to what degree do you think that Kim Jong-un and his cohorts believe the narrative that they push?
I mean, they don't believe in anything they're saying because Kim Jong-un was educated in Switzerland along with his sister. They know what democracy is, they know what human rights is, and despite that, they are doing that to their own people, and that's why I think they are pure evil. The top elite of Kim Jong-un's, they have incentive to maintain the kingdom as it is, because, as I said, in North Korea, even though you're homogeneous, same genetic people, they divided North Koreans into 51 different classes. We have a caste system based on what your ancestors did. So basically right now, the same resemblance that I see in America is how America is being divided by your skin color. They call my son, who is privileged because his dad is half white. I mean, he's white. So my son's half white. And in America, we have the hierarchy of victimhood, right? It's like, if your skin color is this, you identify as this, like there's more victims and how much you are privileged. In North Korea, it's like that. Like if you're grandfather was a landowner, you are in a low social class. If your grandfather was a communist, you're in a higher social class. So nothing you can do can change your class. Like in America, you cannot change your skin color. In North Korea, you cannot change your ancestors. And it's so heartbreaking that the same tactic that North Korean regime used to divide people is being used in America. Like, people being punished for something they have not done, right? Like, being a white is not a crime. Like, you didn't choose to be white when you're born. Nobody chose that. And in North Korea, when I was born in the country, I was in the lower class because my great-grandfather had a land. He was a landowner. And that's why they said my blood is tainted. My blood is oppressive to other people. Yeah, thank you.
Hey, I was just wondering what you thought of Donald Trump's meeting with Kim Jong-un from like a couple years ago.
Thank you. That's a very funny story because when I was actually one of the open critics during that time of the President Trump. I mean, I was living in New York City and everybody was telling me that he's a dictator like Kim Jong-un, you know. And I was very confused. I just came to America. He was a president and everybody's saying that he's a dictator. And then that was also the only time the New York Times wants to put me on their news like paper. Me to criticizing President Trump. That was the only time BBC, Time Magazine, everybody called me. How he met with Kim Jong-un seems like to me is that because he's coming from a business background, he thought he could just make a deal, you know, like putting up a hotel in a like desert or casino or something. I think he really underestimated that this regime has lasted 80 years. They are extremely logical and they are also behaving in the interest of China behind. So I thought that meeting Kim Jong-un, giving him the legitimacy, was not worth it. And I do think that though Trump had good intentions, that he really genuinely thought he could give that Kim Jong-un some trust so he could open up the country and, you know, denuclearize the country, but of course that didn't happen. So it's too bad that, you know, good intentions always not lead to good path. Thank you.
When you first came to America, what was the most shocking thing that you found besides the things you've already talked about?
It was very interesting to me. I mean, so many things, but you know how, again, like having too much can be a problem. You know, all my friends were going to like Equinox gym. Do you know what that is in New York? I don't have a gym membership because like I work so much already. But you know, my friends, like, their problem was, like, eating so much food, so now they have to lose weight. And then there's a dating app, but there's too many guys. They don't know what to decide, so they now need to go to therapists to talk about it each week. And it was very confusing because I was living in New York City. I was assumed that everybody got to be very happy, and, like, they were not. They were really miserable, and my agent was asking me at some point, like, Yeonmi, you need to go see a therapist. I was like, what's therapy? Right? For North Korean, we don't even have the vocabulary for therapy or trauma. So it seems that when there's no actual very hardship existence, it does make people lose some perspective and weakens humans' ability to deal with the situation. So it's very interesting. I'm becoming that every day too. I'm becoming more weaker. So yeah.
Hi, I have two questions. Uh-huh. They're all about what we can do about North Korea. Mm-hmm. So first, what can like us as Americans do against to oppose oppressive regimes like North Korea? And also what should the U.S. and countries on the international stage do to oppose oppressive regimes?
Yeah, the first question is very important question. I think this is where the credit goes to President Trump. He made it clear to a lot of people that the responsibility lies in Chinese Communist Party. They've been propping up this regime over the last 80 years. North Korea cannot last even 1 week without Chinese support. And this is exactly Chinese doing. So I think we need to elect the politicians to understand the threat of China, the threat they are causing to the rest of humanity. And I think we need to spread these words in America too, because most of people don't understand that they somehow think North Korea exists on their own, not without Chinese help. I think that is more like political level that we can do. And the second level is, of course, that you can engage in this there are missionary groups still rescuing North Koreans. There are 300,000 of them are still in China hiding. And you can rescue one person for $2,000. So it's like during the Holocaust, you know, there were people who saved the Jewish people, and like that, you can save these people if you are willing. And there are many NGOs working on this issue right now. Yeah.
Thank you. This next question will be our last question. Thank you.
Hi, I'm South Korean, first of all. Yeah, so thank you for coming here. So my question will be, is there gonna be any possibilities for North Koreans to earn their freedom back? Or if so, what do you think that would be the best possible scenario that could happen?
Yeah, thank you for the question. Unification just happened here. The only possibility of North Korean regime crumbling is if Chinese Communist Party crumbles. Their, you know, survivor is depending on Chinese survivor, like CCP's survivor. So really, question is going to that. And if China somehow miraculously changes their direction and becoming more democratic and becoming more humane, or they collapse themselves and become more democratic system comes in, then North Korea follow the exact same path. And I think that would be the best scenario, you know, that like 1.4 billion people in China are free, North Koreans are free, and so many people will gain freedom because of collapse of CCP. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Park.
Thank you so much, everyone.
Good evening.